Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Mafia Hitman, Carmine DiBiase, The Wiseguy Who Really Killed Joey Gallo, by Frank Dimatteo and Michael Benson, narrated by Eric Jason Martin. Everybody's a gangster, until a real gangster walks into the room. John Gotti. Introduction. Irish bullshit. Now, a lot of yous have seen The Irishman, the Martin Scorsese picture on Netflix. Or maybe you read the book I Heard You Paint Houses by Charles Brandt. Both tell the supposedly true story of Frank Sheeran, Robert De Niro in the movie, a big beefy guy who grew up in Darby, Pennsylvania, which is suburban Philadelphia. He was only half Irish, but the Swede would have made a lousy title for the movie. Sheeran was in the army during World War II and fought his way across North Africa, Sicily, Italy, France, and Germany. He accumulated more than a year's worth of combat duty, even taking out the month and a half and totally spent AWOL getting drunk and fucking the native girls. He killed a lot of men in combat, but participated in countless massacres as well, wiping out German POWs so he wouldn't have to guard them. Killing, he said, came easy for him. After the war, he worked legit until 1955, when he went to work for Pennsylvania crime boss Russ Buffalino, doing this and that, including whacking a guy now and again. The reason we're interested in Sheeran at all is because he claimed to have committed some high-profile hits, including those on Joey Gallo, leader of the President Street Boys, and Union bigwig Jimmy Hoffa. I know nothing about what happened to Jimmy Hoffa. I heard all of the same ridiculous rumors as everyone else, like that he was buried underneath the end zone in Giants Stadium. But I do know about the hit on Joey Gallo, as do the police and the FBI. If the writer of the Paint Houses book and the makers of the movie had looked into it, they would have realized that there were a lot of things wrong with Sheeran's story regarding that horrible night in Umberto's clam house. First and foremost, Sheeran claimed that he shot Joey from the bar when everyone, eyewitnesses, forensics, etc., agrees that the bullets went in the other direction, from the side door toward the bar. Sheeran also said that he chased Joey outside and gave him the coup de grace in the street. Everyone again agrees that the only shots outside the restaurant were return fire at the killers as they tried to escape. There were other problems with Sheeran's story. He said he was a precision shot, claimed he wounded but didn't kill Pete the Greek on purpose, and that all of his bullets struck their target, when it's clear that there were plenty of shots that missed. Bullets came from four different guns, a .32, two .38s, and Pete the Greek's .25 Titan. At 5 a.m., when Joey was killed, the streets of Little Italy were pretty deserted as they get. But in New York City, there's always someone around. And sure enough, cops found witnesses who saw the flight of the getaway car. They said it was a tan or brown sedan, not Sheeran's car. Great movie. Decent book. True history? No fucking way. Frank Sheeran may have done a lot of the things he said he did, but he did not shoot Joseph Gregory Joey Gallo. While it is true that Joey had a little run-in with Buffalino on the evening before he died, and that Sheeran may have been there working as Buffalino's bodyguard, we know who hit Joey Gallo. Joey Gallo was shot and killed by a Little Italy hood named Carmine Sonny Pinto DiBiase. And this is the story of how DiBiase and Gallo came together one fateful morning, during the hours before dawn, in a just-opened seafood joint called Umberto's Clam House. Chapter 1. Joey's Back. For most of the time when I was a kid on the President Street block, Joey Gallo was away. I was there because my dad, Ricky Dimatteo, was Larry Gallo's bodyguard, Larry being the oldest of the three Gallo brothers. Larry found my dad, an ex-boxer, in the 1960s when he saw Ricky deck a guy with one punch, even more impressive for the fact that the guy he decked was Emil Griffith, the boxer who went on to be welter and middleweight champion. My dad flattened him, however, and Larry Gallo offered him a job. So he hung out on President Street, where the Gallo crew had their headquarters. Even after Larry died of natural causes, my dad, Ricky, stuck around as a valued member of the Gallo crew. As I grew up, things for the President Street boys seemed to be going well. Scores were made, there was money, swag, the boys seemed to be thriving and having fun. I got to see the fun part up close as my dad threw parties at our house in Freeport, and the guys were all there. But all of that started to crumble the second that Joey Gallo was released from prison on April 11th, 1971. The block on President Street, technically two blocks, was geographically isolated, perfectly positioned for a fortress, with the piers at one end and the Brooklyn Queens Expressway at the other. It wasn't always that way. Here's a mini-history lesson. When Robert Moses, as head of the Triborough Bridge and Tunnel Authority, took up the difficult and cold-blooded duty of running veins, that is, expressways, through old New York City neighborhoods so that cars more efficiently could get to and from the suburbs, a lot of neighborhoods were destroyed. No borough suffered as much as the Bronx. To provide easy access for gas guzzlers to make the commute into the city from Westchester County in Connecticut, the borough was vivisected. The whole southern section of the Bronx went to shit. Brooklyn, where I was born, is larger and survived its adaptation. Much of the Belt Parkway traced a perimeter of swamp that wasn't being used for much anyway. Canarsie lost its little escape spot by the bay, but it was run down and arson bait by that time. Sunset Park lost its main drag, the sunshine gone forever as the highway was built like a roof above the Third Avenue Strip, held aloft by fantastic girders. The sealed-in feel erected a psychological barrier and held the legitimate world out. At night, it was a juvenile delinquent playground. It was so dark that you could dump anything there without worrying about the heat. You could find bodies, sometimes a rusty refrigerator, both riddled with bullet holes. Mom-and-pop restaurants closed. Theaters closed or went porn. Shops under the road on Third Avenue were cursed to perpetual night, and adult storefronts floated, stuck out of time. I'll bet today you can still see raggedy signs in storefront windows offering fetish VHS tapes for cheap. In 2021, the Brooklyn Queens Expressway cruised through Brooklyn Heights beneath a flimsily cantilevered promenade and turned into the Gowanus Parkway that cut through South Brooklyn, separating one part of Red Hook from the rest. But on President Street, Robert Moses's heartless destruction did a wonderful thing. It created an enclave that was easy to defend. The western end of President was now geographically isolated, and that was where the Gallo crew hung out, shot the shit, and planned tactics and strategy. The Gallo brothers grew up in the Kensington section of Brooklyn, but did business out of the President Street block because their maternal grandmother, known as Big Mama or Grandma Nunziato, owned a building there, number 51, and Papa Gallo Umberto had a business there, number 47, before opening Jackie's Charcolette in Kensington. The Gallo boys were always at home on the President Street block. Larry passed while Joey was away, spending the last months of his stretch at Sing Sing. When the day of Joey's release finally came, everybody on the block was excited. It was March 11th, 1971. I was 15, but already at my full height. I was hanging out on the block with my best friend, Anthony Gumbadiel Russo. Gumbadiel and I, being kids, were on a need-to-know basis a lot of the time, which meant we didn't need to know. That said, usually no cars came on the block that we didn't recognize. Maybe every once in a while a new worker from the docks wandered onto the block on foot to get lunch at one of the clubs, but that was about it as far as strangers were concerned. If we did see strangers, we'd say, "You lost? Where yous headed?" But, you know, not in a welcoming way. So we were put on alert when a black Cadillac limo we didn't recognize pulled up to the curb in front of Mondo's club. "What the fuck is this?" Gumbadiel said. We found out quick enough. The day Joey was released, his younger brother, Kid Blast, rented a limo and went up there to pick him up. On the pickup committee with Blast were Joey's longtime best friend, Peter, Pete the Greek, Diopolis, and Tony the Beard, Bernardo. They were loaded for bear, just in case someone tried to hit Joey the second he emerged into the fresh air. When Joey came out of the prison gates and got in the car, the boys were shocked by what they saw. It looked like Joey had been on a decade-long hunger strike. His clothes were hanging on him. His face seemed to be wrapped tightly around his skull. Joey had been off his feed, and eventually he got around to telling his inner circle why. In prison, everything is color-coded, white guys and black guys with no mingling, and Joey had sided with the wrong color. To express their displeasure, Aryan Nation assholes were putting shit in Joey's food, that is, actual feces. The concern over Joey's starvation eased up some the second Joey opened his mouth and began to pinch cheeks. Same old Joey. He might have been pencil thin, but he still had his spirit. The first stop was to see Mama and Papa Gallo at the Gallo House in Kensington. In the car, Joey was trying to catch up on the street situation. Joe Perfacci was gone and Joe Colombo was in, but the situation was still the same. There were still guys out there who thought they could tell Joey what to do, and Joey still didn't like that. God himself could have talked to Joey, and he'd have said, "Fuck you, Lord, I'm my own boss." When Joey got out of prison, he felt like he'd lost too much time, and he was going to make up for it. He wanted to eat every food and live every life. Since he went upstate, the whole world had changed over twice. Imagine trying to deal with the 1970s when you'd missed the 60s. The future shock must have been insane. Everyone was hairier and wore bell-bottoms. But Joey mostly focused on the women. He'd picked up a lot of starch in prison, and the women on the streets were driving him nuts. It was a time when broads went around braless, and Joey's every other comment was about the bouncing boobs. He wanted to fuck them all. He wanted to fuck them all now. Despite Joey's perpetual hard-on, the subject always returned to business, and that motherfucker, Joe Colombo. Perfacci had just been greedy, but by Joey's way of thinking, Colombo was worse. He was greedy as fuck, too, plus he was a hypocrite. He wanted the world to believe he was a legit businessman and worked to get more respect for Italians. The limo pulled up in front of the Gallo House. The Gallo brothers' mom and dad were Umberto and Mary. They came from Torre del Greco, Naples. Papa Gallo came over on the boat in 1920, the SS Canopic, made a living carving religious figures out of stone, and lived at 47 President Street. Papa told the story to anyone who would listen that he could have been as rich as the Rockefellers during Prohibition, but his shipment of booze sank somewhere in the buttermilk channel. Unlike his sons, he knew what it was to put in a back-breaking day of hard labor. Oh, sure, the boys would help their mother flip burgers at Jackie's Charcolette now and again, but real, hand-blistering work they didn't know, and they didn't want to know. Jackie's was where the Colombo crew later delivered Joseph Joe Jelly Joyelli's finger after Jelly was whacked by Joe Yak, Carmine Persico, and John Shimone. Papa Gallo didn't become as rich as a Rockefeller, but he did end up making a bundle selling homemade booze during Prohibition. With that nest egg, he'd backed a major loan-sharking operation and eventually bought a greasy spoon in Kensington and cleaned it up. He called it Jackie's Charcolette, which specialized in what were then called hamburger sandwiches, 15 cents a pop, and chicken plates. Papa these days took it easy. When Papa Gallo was very old, it was my job to pick him up at the Charcolette and drive him to a spot on Henry Street in Red Hook where he liked to play cards. Once I was late, and the roar that came out of that little old man's mouth was terrifying. He roared like the lion in Mondo's basement from the old days on President Street. After the family reunion in Kensington, the boys got back in the limo and headed for President Street. Next stop, Mondo's Club, called the Longshore Restroom. Armando Mondo Iliano was Frank Punchy Iliano's cousin, but the first thing you noticed about him was that he was a midget. His club was a joint where a guy working the docks could get lunch and shoot pool. It was a dingy place, with an oversized picture of a pack of Kents in the front window. The finer the filter, the better the taste. Kent satisfies best, it said. The caddy's back door opened, and Joey Gallo himself got out. Gumbadiel and I went wide-eyed and stopped breathing. I was 6 years old the last time I saw Joey. Now I was 6 feet tall. But Joey took one look at me and smiled with recognition. "You're Ricky's kid," Joey said. I beamed. "Yeah," I said. He said, "You know, if anything happens to your dad, you'll always have a home on the block." I blinked twice and said, "Thanks, Joey." He pinched both of my cheeks, hard, and nodded at Gumbadiel. "Do me a favor, kid, wash the car," he said. We washed the car. Now, a lot of people have told the Joey Gallo story, folks who didn't know and weren't there. My dad was with Joey's brother, so they saw each other a lot, and I was the little kid. My primary memory of Joey from when I was small was him pinching my cheek so hard that tears came to my eyes. He told Ricky he was teaching me to be tough, and they laughed. The Gallo brothers grew up on the block, from the days when they were juvenile delinquents. Right there, just inland from the international piers, in the most mob-dominated community in the country. Joey went to PS 179 on Avenue C in the Kensington section of Brooklyn, then the Brooklyn High School of Automotive Trades in Williamsburg, but he dropped out as soon as he turned 16. He was in a car crash, got a bump on his head, and developed a nervous tic. Joey and his best pal, Peter Pete the Greek Diapolis, hung out at the candy store on 36th Street and 14th Avenue. Pretty soon, they were joined by a third, Punchy Iliano. Mostly, they shot eight ball in the Ace pool room on Church Avenue, upstairs from Joey's mom's lunch joint, and talked about places they should bump off. Lots of kids talked like that, but this was different. These guys had the balls to carry out their plans. They planned and executed scores, then came home and shared the swag. Even then, Joey had an explosive personality. Once, when the Greek and Joey were kids, they went horseback riding in Prospect Park. Joey couldn't get his horse to turn the way he wanted it to, so he got off the horse, circled around in front, and punched it in the face. In a world filled with swarthy Italian guys, Joey was different. He was blonde, like his mother. He couldn't have looked less Sicilian, but he was movie star handsome, and he carried himself like he was infused with Hollywood, jamming a wide-brimmed fedora hat on his head and laughing like Richard Widmark in Kiss of Death, rhythmically flipping a silver dollar like George Raft in Some Like It Hot, until you had to wonder if he was really nuts or if it was an act to scare people. Because, believe me, he scared the living shit out of people. He became a national figure in 1959, about 16 months after making his bones as part of the hit squad that whacked Albert the Mad Hatter, Anastasia, in Grasso's barber shop. His fame came the day he testified before the Senate Select Committee on Improper Activities in the Labor or Management Field, handling questions from the investigation's chief counsel, Robert F. Kennedy, you've heard of him, by taking the Fifth while wearing Ray-Ban sunglasses. Do you, Joseph Gallo, solemnly swear the evidence you shall give before this Senate Select Committee shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Sure. Pardon me, Mr. Gallo? I do. Joey lit a cigarette. Mr. Gallo, could you tell us where you were born, just a little bit about your background? Kennedy said. Joey looked around until he found the TV camera. It said Channel 5 on it. I respectfully decline to answer because I honestly believe my answer might tend to incriminate me. Where did you go to school? Can you tell us that? Joey took his right arm and swept it outward, knocking a glass of water and an ashtray off the table and onto the floor. I respectfully decline to answer because I honestly believe my answer might tend to incriminate me. Kennedy persisted. He asked Joey how and why he got into the union business. He asked Joey if he was married, if his mother and father were living. The answer was always the same. I respectfully declined to answer because I honestly believe my answer might tend to incriminate me. It couldn't have sounded more like Joey was saying, "Fuck you, Bobby Kennedy." Now it was the senators who were nervously lighting up cigarettes. By the time Joey was dismissed as a witness, he was a star. That part America saw on television. What they only heard about was Joey's behavior off-camera, jollying RFK's secretary in his office, and commenting that Kennedy's rug would be nice for a dice game. Joey later laughed at press reports remarking on the fashion statement he'd made during his television debut. It was just the way he dressed. That expensive designer shirt they wrote about was actually purchased at an Army-Navy store. He'd paid a dollar for it. As you probably know, Joey's nickname, never ever uttered in his presence, was Crazy Joe. Ever since he was a kid, there were suspicions that he had bats in his belfry. Some thought it was real, some thought it was an act. Most came to the conclusion that it was a unique combo of the two. Joey and his President Street crew were still just barely grown-ups when they began to carve out a piece of the racket's pie, taking over coin-operated machines and portions of the policy bank. By 1958, Joey Gallo had already been a star of the underworld for 6 or 7 years. Papa Gallo married Mary Nunziata, and they had 5 kids. Joey Gallo was the middle brother of 3, with Larry, 2 years older, and Albert Jr., a.k.a. Kid Blast, 1 year younger. A lot of people think that Blast got his name from shooting people, but that's not the case. The real story, we knew, was that Blast was Albert's favorite synonym for fuck, as in, I gave her a good blast. Joey also had 2 sisters, Carmella and the baby, Jackie. Joey had first showed up on the public radar way back in 1950 when, at age 20, he got popped for burglary, showed up for his court hearing in a black zoot suit, and laughed like Widmark at the judge. His performance was so bizarre that the judge had Joey taken to Kings County Hospital to be checked out by a shrink, the first of many such tests. They gave him the Rorschach test. "What does this look like to you, Mr. Gallo?" "Looks like you spilled ink on the paper and folded it over," he replied. Joey got to the point where he ate psychiatric examinations for breakfast. They told him he was a paranoid schizophrenic, a phrase Joey liked and often used when trying to convince some schlub that he should not fall behind on his payments. "I'm a paranoid schizophrenic. No telling what I'll do," Joey would say. The guy would always pay up. It was a technique almost as effective as having a lion in the basement. My conclusion is that there was always something calculated about Joey's madness. It had its own intelligence, but lacked a sense of nuance. It sharpened his focus and gave him a joyful sense of purpose. But you couldn't be completely sane and act the way he did either. Over the years, he became a master at the insanity test given by government shrinks, always being diagnosed with this or that, but immediately being released back onto the streets. The doctors who didn't tell him he was a paranoid schizophrenic told him he had pseudo-psychopathic schizophrenia. He told those shrinks, "Fuck you," and let loose with his craziest insane gangster laugh. If you don't remember Richard Widmark playing Tommy Udo, that laugh was also used by Frank Gorshin when he played the Riddler on the old Batman TV show. So, Joey was complicated. A lot of the guys lived in America but considered themselves Italian. The music they listened to, the food they ate, all Italian. Joey embraced things that were pure American, including the behavior and style associated with African Americans. He dug jazz, cool clothes, and jive talk. He knew all the beatnik jargon. As teens, the Gallo brothers formed a crew called the Cockroach Gang and they ruled the turf around Sackett Street and Fourth Avenue, at the bottom of Park Slope in the Gowanus Canal section of Brooklyn. The cockroaches hung out at the same time as the Persico brothers' Garfield boys, who ran the turf along Garfield Place in Park Slope, just up the hill from the cockroaches, and the two clubs were rivals and then allies. Joey talked a lot of shit, and he loved to tell people he ran with bums from the time he was a little boy, operated his first crap game at 11, and by puberty was an established street kid, running numbers for a profachi guy. In 1948, he joined the U.S. Navy to see the world and got the boot after 6 months for emotional immaturity. Some guys, and I know this to be true from personal experience, aren't good at taking orders or being called a maggot or whatever other abuse Joey had to endure during basic training. He got out of the service, returned to the streets, and he and his brothers ran their own crew out of President Street. Joey's brother Larry hired my dad, who was working as a bouncer at a joint called the Wagon Wheel, to be his bodyguard. Like most hoods, Joey was nocturnal. He'd be getting to bed about the time others were waking up to the clanging and banging of metal trash and ash cans being tossed around by the sanitation department. Joey was slippery regarding the law. As a young man, his only pop was for the burglary in 1950, and he skated. The Garfields and the cockroaches grew into young adulthood, sort of blended, and worked the rackets under the auspices of Frankie Schatz Abadamarco, a big-time Bensonhurst bookie and policy banker who ran profachi operations in South Brooklyn. Thus, whenever a President Street boy got in a jam, profachi sent the best lawyers, and he was back in Mondo's having a drink before dark. But Joey didn't like being under anyone's auspices, and from very early on, he ran his own operations, from which he paid tribute to no one. The movie gangster inside his brain thought in very simplistic terms sometimes and had delusions of grandeur. He wasn't going to be happy until he was the don of his own crime family, or he was dead, whichever came first. Joey's crew reflected his modern thinking. He didn't believe in the exclusivity preached by the men who came over from the old country. He didn't give a shit if a man was Sicilian or Italian or whatever. He based his judgments on other qualities. His crew had a Greek, a Jew, a Puerto Rican, two Syrians, an Egyptian, an Irishman, and a bunch of Italians, one of whom was a midget. And yeah, for a while there was a mountain lion named Cleo in Mondo's basement. Joey and Larry were in on the Albert Anastasia hit in 1957, and as a result were made by profachi. Joey's sponsor at his initiation ceremony was Frankie the Bug Caruso. The move to give the elder Gallo brothers buttons was controversial, but the whacking of Anastasia in his barber chair in the middle of the hustling and bustling of Manhattan was so spectacular that profachi had to let them in. Besides, they were good earners. Independent thinkers, yes, but they were young. Profachi thought maybe they'd grow out of it. No one stayed an independent thinker long in the mob. You either learned to obey, or you were found disassembled and floating in Jamaica Bay. Profachi was warned against it. Don't make the gallows. They didn't want Joey for the same reason the Navy didn't want him. He couldn't take orders. He was always going to do his own thing, no matter what. And so, after a decade of hell locked in prison, Joey came back out into the sunshine. He had only been out for a couple of days, briefed by the boys about the situation, when he started to yell that he was going to kill all of those Colombo motherfuckers. Joey was not afraid of change. He needed change. He needed for things to be happening, to be in a state of flux. "You don't understand," he once said. "I need to get off." He restructured his life, and then he did it again. He would never stop. Joey's first wife, the former feathered Vegas showgirl Jeffy Lee Boyd, was best known for her exceptional tits and ass. She lived in Bohemian Central, that is Greenwich Village, on Eighth Street, a tenement building with a garden in the backyard. Joey and Jeffy met in a beatnik pad, and he started hanging out there, the first indication to the President Street boys that this bohemian shit had an appeal to Joey, that he didn't just think about jukeboxes and scores. Jeffy had lots of contacts in the jazz world. Her first husband had been sax legend Jerry Mulligan. Joey could rap about poetry and life's great mysteries. Joey wanted to be in show business, not to perform, but to get his cut, just like he got a cut of so many bars and restaurants. He dug jazz and wanted to manage bass player Charles Mingus. Joey could mix with that crowd in a way other hoods couldn't even comprehend. He'd sit on the floor of a Lower East Side flat, one with the tub in the kitchen, and talk beatnik shit, how he'd seen the great balls of his generation blown out by hot lead. Jeffy was a piece of work in her own right. She told Joey again and again that he was too soft, and he should be tougher on people. Sometimes when he had to hurt a guy, he felt sympathy. "Joey, snap out of it," Jeffy would say. "Do your job. Don't be such a fucking head case." But Joey could not be complicated. He had created a character in his mind, a movie gangster, and that was the guy he became whenever the job called for it. Jeffy and Joey were an item for a long time before they got married. They didn't get married until a few months before he went away. In fact, she was pregnant when Joey headed upstate. Joey's daughter, Joey, never really knew her dad. He was in prison for the first decade of her life, and preoccupied once he got out. Jeffy had been busy while Joey was upstate. She had divorced Joey, married a rich Englishman, and lived the high life. But there was something about Joey that was still in her blood, and when she heard Joey was getting out, she divorced her limey beau and came knocking on Joey's door, purring like a kitten. Joey and Jeffy were remarried after he got out, and they moved in together in a 21-story apartment building on 14th Street near 5th Avenue, on the northern border of Greenwich Village. The choice of apartment buildings was kismet for Joey. He had a problem with a tooth and went to a dentist on the ground floor of the building. The dentist wasn't memorable, but his assistant, a divorcee named Sina Essery, made little red hearts fly out of Joey's blue eyes. Sina had long dark hair, green eyes, and the kind of prettiness that Joey associated with beauty pageant contestants. He asked her where she lived, and she said with a laugh, "Right upstairs. I can commute to work without going outside." Joey told her he lived in the building too, and she reacted like that was good news. For a while, Joey had Jeffy downstairs and Sina upstairs. Jeffy referred to Sina, who had been a country girl in her youth, as Joey's hillbilly whore. Jeffy wondered out loud why the hillbilly whore lived in the building's penthouse, an apartment larger and more expensive than theirs. Well, she didn't really wonder. She knew the answer. Sina did more for the dentist than just clean teeth. Jeffy correctly guessed that Sina's apartment was being paid for by her employer, the dentist, who was not her ex-husband. When Jeffy pointed this out to Joey, he cuffed her around pretty good. That only made Jeffy mouthier, and the violence escalated. It peaked during a New Year's Eve party on President Street. Both Jeffy and Joey had been into the cocktails pretty good, and she wouldn't shut up. Joey's threshold for frustration was never great, like when he punched the horse, for example. When Joey had had it with his wife, he grabbed her by the arm and dragged her into the other room so the other partiers could hear but not see him beating her. Before long, Jeffy was out and Sina was in. Jeffy found out her marriage was over when she got home one day and a moving van was out in front of her building and her stuff was being loaded into it. The driver said he had instructions to take her stuff to California. After moving Jeffy's stuff out, Joey had all of his stuff taken up the elevator to Sina's penthouse. The dentist was out of luck, except lucky to be alive. The dentist no longer paid the rent. Joey divorced Jeffy for the second time and moved into the penthouse with Cena and Cena's young daughter, Lisa. When Joey went to parties, and he went to many parties, everyone remembered him. Not big, but tough. And so, so cool. Joey Gallo was the only mobster in New York who showed up on the society pages. He was a trendsetter. His fashion sense was both daring and impeccable. Plus, he was an intellectual, a guy who could sip a cocktail and discuss the commonalities between film noir and German expressionism. His new penthouse apartment had a section set aside for his easel. He'd taken up painting, colorful images of raw emotion, and the normally snobby art world aristocracy was smitten. He wrote jazzy poetry, and the kids with Van Dyke beards snapped their fingers instead of clapping their hands in appreciation. The Beats came to call on him, smoke dope, and discuss how the Cold War was a hoax. He could talk politics with anyone. He said fascism propped up the paternal hierarchy and thus the repression of the masses. He said he understood communism's appeal, but didn't think it was practical in a world of ambition. And ambition was something Joey knew about. He could talk philosophy, how the ability to distinguish right from wrong was automatically blurred by modern society, that now there was no such thing as right and wrong, just smart and stupid, so you did what you could get away with. He clearly had dreams of being king of the underworld, and yet his cover was as a bohemian, very charming. And he pulled it off. New York's elite, uptown and downtown, embraced Joey Gallo, who had spent so much time away and had so much creativity in his soul. Students and professors of the so-called New Journalism, a freewheeling stream-of-consciousness form of reportage, wrote about Joey like he was Sal Paradise speeding on the sacred urban road. Here was a guy, a violent maniac, who went to prison for a decade, learned the speed-reading technique of Evelyn Wood, and read, and read, and read, and in essence gave himself a graduate degree level of knowledge in just about anything that fell under the liberal arts umbrella. During the last weeks of his life, he was scheduled to appear on TV to discuss the new ways the boys from the press were telling stories. The show was to be called How They Cover Me, and he was scheduled to appear alongside Gore Vidal, Abby Hoffman, Otto Preminger, and Bella Abzug. Joey was on the A-list. As it turned out, the show had to go on without him. He became friends with David Steinberg, a stand-up comic who would go on to have his own TV show. One of Steinberg's funniest characters was a shrink who was nuts himself, who'd shout booga booga at his patients. And you've got to wonder if maybe he didn't, at least a little bit, consider Joey research. Joey wasn't just making showbiz friends. He was befriending people you've heard of, like actors Ben Gazzara, Peter Falk, and Joan Hackett. Writers, too. Perhaps most noteworthy among Joey's bookish pals was playwright Neil Simon, who wrote The Odd Couple. Joey once told a hovering circle of literati that he plowed through 10 books at a time in prison because a prospective writer, himself, had to read like a predator. Joey was aware of the effect he had on people. He scared him, and how ironic it was that he wanted to write like Gregory Corso, to be the Walt Whitman of the streets, maybe write a book of verse called Cracked Bricks. He loved walking into Sardi's, the Times Square restaurant known for its celebrity clientele, because he transcended. Even the celebrities stopped and stared when he came in with the beautiful Cena on his arm. Everyone wondered, how crazy was he, really? Would he know when to stop? Would his history be a comedy or a tragedy? Women thought about other things. How tender could a vicious man be? How charming could a psycho killer be? Would he be writing a book? How could his high-beam eyes look both at you and 1,000 yards beyond you at the same time? Years later, when Bob Dylan wrote a song about him, and newspaper columnist Jimmy Breslin wrote a book about him, and Peter Boyle starred in a movie about him, sort of, it didn't seem strange at all. He was Crazy Joey Gallo, superstar. And Joey bought into the hype, saw himself as a superhero, invulnerable. It was his fatal flaw. Joey and Blast agreed that they should never go off the block together. There should never be a time when the two of them could get whacked together. It was like the president and vice president. They never flew together on the same plane, so in case the plane crashed, one would still be left. It was a situation that couldn't last too long, and didn't. "They ain't gonna kill nobody," Joey kept saying, and he ignored the worried expressions all around. It drove Blast nuts. He'd try to explain to Joey the concept of danger, but Joey didn't get it. Pete the Greek, 5'9 and stocky, and my baptismal godfather, Bobby Darrow, were the guys who were usually around when Joey went out. Pete was Joey's oldest friend. They'd known each other since grade school. Bobby had become a member of the President Street Boys when Joey was away. His real name was Robert Bon Jovi. He had a cousin who was a Colombo capo, but Bobby was with us. Like a lot of the boys, he'd been introduced into the life of adult crime by going through the farm system as a member of a teenaged gang, in this case, the Farragut Road Boys. By the time Bobby turned 21, he already had two notches on his gun. He was a full-fledged madman, a guy who often had a glass of scotch in one hand, a joint in the other. His job was to kill, and he could do it while buzzed. He preferred to do it buzzed. He also excelled at making guys talk, a torturer. He was a torture enthusiast and would hurt guys he was going to kill just to get in some practice. He was a good-looking guy who loved women, and vice versa. He always had a beautiful woman with him, unless he was working. Usually, Joey would bring along protection, but not always. He'd sneak out and walk around the village by himself, and when they found out, Pete and Bobby would have a shit fit. "It's trouble out there, boss." "Yeah, yeah," Joey would say dismissively. "I dig Bleecker Street." Joey believed that conspicuous security was for sissies. Actually, all security, conspicuous or otherwise, was for sissies. But they convinced Joey to have his bodyguards with him when he went out most nights, especially if he was going to be in a public place or a place where they knew there would be other hoods. When he went to parties, his bodyguards didn't have to do much guarding. They were just window dressing for the celebrities, a heightening of the mobby ambiance. While no one was paying attention to the Greek, he was doing a lot of thinking, and he had his doubts about how much this crowd really loved Joey. Seemed like maybe they were just using him. He was this year's it boy, and to have him at your party meant prestige. If you didn't have Joey at your party, folks would think your social status was slipping. Joey's closest friends in the showbiz world were Jerry and Marta Orbach. Jerry at that time was best known for playing gangsters in Broadway musicals. He'd played Mac the Knife in The Three Penny Opera and Sky Masterson in Guys and Dolls, but would later be famous for playing Detective Lenny Briscoe on several Law & Order TV series and as the voice of Lumiere, the candelabra in Disney's animated Beauty and the Beast. Jerry first sought out Joey because he was playing a part in a movie based on Joey, and he considered Joey research. Joey and the Orbachs both happened to be eating at Queen, a restaurant on Court Street in downtown Brooklyn. Jerry came over and introduced himself. They quickly became real friends, Jerry and his socialite and literati wife, Marta. The Greek thought that Marta Orbach maybe was the biggest user of all. She wanted to co-write Joey's autobiography. First of all, that struck the Greek as a bad idea, because everything in Joey's life that would be worth reading about was also a forbidden topic. Plus, the Greek didn't like the idea that Mrs. Orbach saw Joey as a money-making opportunity. Joey, on the other hand, liked the book idea a lot. Joey figured he needed to tell his own story on account of how Jimmy Breslin had written a novel about us called The Gang That Couldn't Shoot Straight, which pissed off everybody on President Street because it made us look like clowns. The real story needed to be told, So when Marta expressed an interest, Joey jumped at it. Marta wrote a book proposal and reportedly got an offer from Viking Press, but by that time Joey's days were numbered. Joey, to his credit, seemed to understand his role at those showbiz parties and always dressed the part. He was slow to adjust to 1970s clothes styles anyway, but to go out, he wore what he'd always worn at night as far back as the 1950s, dark shirt, white tie, pinstriped suit. He couldn't have looked more like a gangster, and that made those artsy types real happy. It would have been great if Joey had stayed on President Street and life had gone on as it was, but that wasn't what happened. He didn't hang out, and I only saw him a couple times after that first day. I didn't hang around on the block much after that either. My dad warned me. "Frankie boy, it's okay to stay away from the block more. There are cops all over the fucking place." I knew what Ricky meant. Joey was gonna fuck with the Colombos, and he was gonna fuck with them hard. Ricky told me that there were new rules. No one was to go to Colombo for anything. We were independent of them, not with them in any way. That meant we were not to participate in any Colombo-sanctioned scores. We were not to eat at Colombo restaurants, no drinking in Colombo bars. If we were on one of our own operations, scores, skims, whatever it was, we were not to partner or involve ourselves in any way with anyone from the Colombo crew. At least once, Joe Yak Iacovelli, Colombo consigliere, went to the commission and lobbied for Joey's removal from the earth. Joe Colombo had been taken out of the picture, shot by a black guy, and that had to mean Joey was behind it. Lots more about the hit on Colombo later. But the commission nixed Joe Yak's scheme, saying it would start a war. Besides, Colombo Lieutenant Carmine Jr. Persico was at that time trying to win an appeal on his hijacking conviction, and hot publicity like that, spawned by big mob hits, could fuck things up. Joe Yak eventually said fuck it, and made his own plans to bump off Joey Gallo. Somebody had to do it, he figured. As Albert Anastasia used to teach his torpedoes back in the Murder, Inc. days, the key to a successful hit was preparation. Follow your target. Get to know his patterns, his routines. Then you can lay in wait at the point where he is most vulnerable and escape easiest. So, Yak's crew sought intelligence, eyewitness, and hearsay about the comings and goings of Joey Gallo. But it was a frustrating exercise, as Joey Gallo didn't have a routine, and his movements were seemingly without pattern. Yak couldn't stake out the President Street block and wait for Joey to show up, because the NYPD always had cops, the pizza squad, posted there to prevent attacks. Still, there had to be a way. Yak became frustrated. It was Persico who came up with the next plan. There were some things that an ex-con needed to make routine, things like visiting the parole board. The complicating factor in this plan was that Joey's parole officer was located on a congested block.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.